Eastern Islands.
A place of peace and tranquility. With dramatic coastlines to explore. Oh, wow. It's a place with its own unique cultures and traditions. Where historic industry is found alongside the new. With hidden beauty around every corner. Lovely. These are the islands of the Hebrides.
From the mainland, our journey will take us to Arran, from where we head to the Inner Hebrides, travelling north to Skye. From here, we cross to Lewis at the northern tip of the Outer Hebrides and travel south to our end point on the Isle of Barra, a trip covering more than 1,000 miles. In the final stage of our journey, we explore the Outer Hebrides, travelling from Lewis in the north and through Harris to the Uist and Eriskay in the south, before reaching the end point of the journey, the Island of Barra. Along the route, we discover how a local tradition has become world-renowned. Explore the rich settlement history that these islands continue to reveal.
Crofter and his family would have sat by the fire, relaxing, keeping warm.
And we witness the changes that the introduction of a solid transport infrastructure is having on the island communities. Archipelago, located 30 miles west of the mainland and stretching for 135 miles north to south, the Outer Hebrides have been described as a perfect mix of sandy beaches, rugged mountains, abundant wildlife, and a rich and vibrant culture. Stretching from Lewis in the north through to Bernarray at the southern tip, the island chain consists of over 70 named individual isles, with only 14 permanently inhabited.
Behind me is our first glimpse of the Outer Hebrides, the island of Lewis.
One of the largest islands in the Hebrides, Lewis is comparatively lower lying than its neighbours, with its more fertile soils providing a base for human settlement for millennia. The earliest archaeological remains dating back 5,000 years. As such, the island has a rich history, with many monuments and relics still to be seen today. Lewis's landscape can be categorised into two kinds. The east coast features sandy beaches with dunes and rolling macaire, while in stark contrast, the west coast is more rugged, with rocky cliffs and small coves. As a result, the majority of the population are located along the east coast, with the island's interior consisting of large areas of uninhabitable peat moorland.
We're off the ferry that you can see sailing away in the distance, and we arrived at Tarbert on the island of Harris, which is joined to the island of Lewis and will be our next destination.
After travelling the short distance to Lewis, we continue onto the largest settlement on the island and the administrative centre of the Outer Hebrides, the town of Stornoway on the east coast.
We're at Stornoway and we've just arrived at the Lewis Loom Centre. It's one of the places where the famous Harris tweed is made and sold.
The Harris tweed industry dates back to 1846, when Lady Dunmore, widow of the landowner of Harris, chose to have her clan tartan replicated in tweed. Seeing how successful the results were, Lady Dunmore began selling the tweed to her friends, and eventually to traders countrywide. The industry grew year on year, reaching its height in the early 20th century, with Harris tweed remaining the world's only commercially produced hand-woven tweed to this day. However, with popularity came imitations, and as a result, it has been protected by law since 1911. Today, to be certified as Harris Tweed, the fabric must have been hand-woven by the islanders at their homes in the Outer Hebrides. Finished in the Outer Hebrides, and made from pure virgin wool, dyed and spun in the Outer Hebrides. Only if these criteria are met can the tweed be stamped with the orb symbol and sold as Harris Tweed.
Probably a bit big, isn't it? A bit big, that one. Just trying on the Harris Tweed jackets, just to see which one fits. That's nice material. Let's try this one, looks a bit smaller. Is it better?
2012 saw the highest levels of tweed production for almost 15 years. A resurgence led by several major clothing brands.
And as you can see, I am wearing a Harris Tweed jacket. However, you can get so much more than just jackets. You can buy Harris Tweed hats, Harris Tweed scarves, and even a Harris Tweed teddy bear.
However, it's not just tweed which Stornoway has to offer. We're here on the day of the Lewis Carnival, a celebration of the island.
So the streets are lined with people, all here to see the Lewis Carnival.
Floats, some reflecting local issues, the atmosphere is one of celebration, something which adds to the vibrant and unique sense of community which exists here on Lewis. It is also that community spirit and the need never to forget which was partly responsible for the construction of this monument, the Lewis War Memorial. Located just outside the town centre and built on the 300 feet high Knock Nan Uan, the highest point in Stornoway, the memorial serves as a reminder to those below of the sacrifices of 1,151 Lewis men made during the First World War. Unveiled in September 1924, the 85 feet Scottish baronial tower is divided internally into four separate chambers, representing the four parishes of Lewis, each with its own plaque of those who gave their lives. However, the Scottish weather took its toll, and despite remedial work, the tower has sadly remained closed since 1975. The plaques relocated to a purpose-built stone circle, where the names of the 376 souls lost in the Second World War joined them. Leaving Stornoway, we travel onto the west coast of the island to discover traditional ways of life that have now disappeared.
We've arrived at the Black House Village, a whole series of traditional crofters' houses.
Garenin is a preserved Black House village, which until the early 1970s was still occupied by crofting families. Of low height with thickly thatched roofs and double dry stone walls, these houses were built to withstand even the harshest of Hebridean weather. Today, this unique conservation site represents a different style of heritage, with the black houses converted into self-catering and hostel accommodation. However, in order to get a better glimpse of what life was like living in the Black House, we've come to the Arnold Black House Museum, the last remaining Black House preserved as a crofter's home. Dating back to 1880, this Black House, number 42 Arnold, formed part of the Arnold settlement, a small cluster of crofting homes whose history dates back some 2,000 years.
We're currently in the smaller of the two buildings that make up the Black House. This is the first smaller one, and it is a storeroom for storing various equipment that the crofter who lived here might need. There is an adjoining door to the larger section of the Black House, so let's go through there now. It's quite low, so mind your head. But as we duck under here and move through, we end up in the larger section of the house. As we turn to our left, we find a room that was used for livestock, where the crofter could put his sheep, goats, or even horses to protect them from the weather outside. As we move back through and into the third room, we find the living quarters, where the crofter would sit, relax, eat, and also keep warm by the fire, which, as you can see, is currently lit. The crofter and his family would have sat by the fire, relaxing, keeping warm, and they probably would have eaten in here as well. This would have been the hub, and indeed the chain here coming down to the fire probably would have had a big cooking pot with a big Scottish broth in it, which they would have tucked into after it had been cooked. It does feel very homely, actually. There's nice furniture and plates and pots and nice bench here to sit on, and the fire is extremely warm. It would certainly keep you warm on a winter's day, that's for sure. The smell of smoke in this room is quite poignant on the nose. There's very few ventilation holes. I can't see any in the roof, and there are only small windows for ventilation and light. As we move through this room, we come to the final room in the Black House, which is the bedroom. And this is where the crofter would have slept. Here are some crofters in the house. And these are the beds. A wooden box with what looks like Harris tweed blankets. I'm sure it would be nice and warm and snug. The fire certainly provides a lot of heat, and there are also curtains here that you could draw to keep out any light that there was, or keep the heat in. I'm going to try out the bed to see how comfortable it is. I doubt there's a mattress, but let's try. Oh, yes, it's just a wooden bottom with lots of rugs. But I think if you had a lot of Harris tweed rugs, it would be quite comfortable in here. And that is the Black House. That is the totality of it. But certainly, it's quite a windy day today, and it's very sheltered in here, and quite quiet as well. So I think it would have been a very pleasant little place to live, to shelter from the weather outside.
This was a residence for both people and animals, with no chimney and a fire which was always lit. This had advantages, including warmth for its occupants, with the peat smoke also killing any insects present in the roof. However, this wasn't necessarily a healthy way to live, and new health regulations introduced in the 20th century required humans and animals to be kept separate, chiming the end of these cosy and practical houses. Evidence of a rich history of settlement and local industry can be seen in nearly every part of the island, and you don't have to look hard to find it. As we head towards the Callanish Standing Stones, the next port of call on our very own Lewis Heritage Trail, we come across the Norse Iron Age mill and kiln at Shorewast. Located near the shoreline of Loch Roenvar, these restored buildings provide a valuable insight into Iron Age life here. Just a short distance further south are the famous Neolithic Callanish Standing Stones.
What are the Callanish Stones? A series of large standing stones, such as these two here. They form a cross pattern with a circular set of stones in the middle. It was built about 4,000 years ago. No one knows exactly why. Some say it was built for spiritual and religious reasons, whereas others say it was an astronomical observatory. Or perhaps they were just a bit bored and wanted something to do.
The position and unique layout of the site, with stones radiating in four directions from the centre, has led many to believe that it was linked with astronomical events, but it's impossible to know in exactly what way. Whatever the inspiration was, the construction of similar circles and henges spread rapidly throughout the country, and evidence in the area surrounding Callanish suggests that the site remained an active focus for religious activity for at least another 1500 years. Today, the site is a popular tourist attraction, with a visitor centre and obligatory cafe nearby, a far cry from its prehistoric origins. But Lewis's visible history doesn't end there. To the south of the stones and off the island's west coast is Great Bonera, a small but historically significant island, linked to Lewis by bridge since 1953.
This landscape of mountains and locks was witness to the Bonera riots of 1874, a show of resistance by the local population against the Highland clearances. As bailiffs arrived to evict them from their homes, they were pelted with clods of earth, leading to many arrests. Eventually, the local crofters marched on Lewis Castle, where they demanded an audience with the owner of the island. The resulting court case ended in a monumental victory for the Highland crofters.
The island's earlier history, however, was a lot less violent.
We're looking for the Bosda Iron Age house. I believe it's a bit further down this coastal path. Well, I believe we have found what we're looking for. This is the Bosda Iron Age house. It's a reconstruction, but it was built using techniques that were available at the time, so it's a very accurate reconstruction. It's built near the site of an Iron Age village, which is further down on the beach behind me. The village consisted of three of these style jelly baby houses, but it was covered by sand until a storm in the 1990s uncovered some of the houses. It was then excavated, but then recovered with sand to prevent any further damage occurring to the houses. If you look carefully enough, you can see the outlines of the houses on the beach.
Located on Bosda Beach and occupied between the 6th and 9th centuries, this small crofting settlement lived off the natural resources that Bonera had to offer, through farming, fishing and hunting. The main settlement consisted of several semi-sunken circular buildings, which probably extended across the width of the beach. In fact, the style of building was very similar to that of the Black Houses, with double dry stone walls providing insulation from the elements. After this period of occupation, there is evidence the site continued to be of value, with a later Norse settlement found to be built on top during further excavations. From Great Bonera, we return south to the Isle of Harris. Although not physically separated from Lewis, they are seen by their respective communities as individual isles, culturally, socially, and environmentally. Harris is an area famed for its traditions and strong sense of community, characteristics which are also shared with its small neighbouring isle.
We're on the wee island of Scalpe. It's a very small place, only about 2.5 square miles. It has a population of about 300. Most of the people that live here speak Gaelic, and indeed the islanders help to run the island along with the North Harris Community Trust.
This partnership was formed in late 2012, when the island's then owner, London businessman Fred Taylor, offered residents the island for free, in what was to become the largest gifted community land acquisition in Scotland. Once described as a hotbed of Hebridean industry, Scalpe's economy had faced decline since the 1970s, with many businesses closing, resulting in the island's population falling by half in the the same period. Therefore, residents voted to accept this offer and also to work in partnership with the local community trust to maintain and develop the island, opening up new funding opportunities to get things moving. This innovative approach has already resulted in the strengthening of an already established community-owned shop, in addition to the founding of a new net washing facility operating out of a previously disused fish processing plant, creating new jobs and local economic growth in an area where tourism has limited reach. With infrastructure already in place, linking Scalpay with Harris, it is hoped that this growth and economic diversification can continue.
We're on the top of Scalpay Bridge. It was built in 1997 and opened by Tony Blair and Scalpay's oldest resident, who was 103 at the time. It replaced the ferry service between Scalpay and Harris.
Spanning 300 metres, the bridge received a 65% grant towards its construction from the EU, representing the importance that this vital link has in bolstering the island's economic development and community access, allowing people to live here, yet work in other areas of the Outer Hebrides. But the bridge isn't the only clearly visible infrastructure in place on Scalpay's rugged coastline.
Behind me is the Eileen Glass Lighthouse. Operational in 1789, it was the first lighthouse to be built in the Hebrides. It was recently involved in a scandal where the owners of the lighthouse had set up a fake charity, earning them over £100,000. The money wasn't put towards a charity, but instead to pay off their own mortgage on the lighthouse.
Standing at 73 feet in height, the present light tower replaced the original wooden tower in 1824 and was built by Robert Stevenson, who in later years would become world-renowned. The weather can be harsh here, however, and the light and foghorn system helped protect passing vessels from the island's outlying rocks. When the first keeper retired, he was said to be weather-beaten and stiff from years of exposure to the elements. Today, the lighthouse can be seen as a potential asset to an island which is community-owned, and something which is growing as a tourist attraction. Scalpay is an island which is gradually adjusting to life after its industrial heyday, and the future is bright. One of the most important factors in this success is its proud sense of community and individualism, something which I hope it will always retain, no matter how popular it becomes. South Harris is said to be home to some of the best beaches in Scotland. The island's winding coastal road takes us past many sandy bays and dunes, but our destination is by far the largest and perhaps the most spectacular beach Harris has to offer. Lus Kentire.
Well, I think we've made it. And isn't this pleasant? This is nice. Oh, how lovely. It makes me want to get a bucket and spade and run onto the beach in my swimming trunks, you'll be glad to hear. Start digging sandcastles and, I don't know, maybe get a deck chair as well and have a lie down on the beach. Oh, this is lovely. This beach has very good reviews, if there is such a thing as beach reviews. But it is claimed to be one of the most beautiful beaches in the Hebrides. And you can really see why. You've got golden sand on either side of you, stretching for miles. Rugged mountains and landscapes surrounding. And of course, the water, which all adds to the feel of the place, the atmosphere. I think if it wasn't for these very Scottish-looking mountains, you wouldn't even know you were in Scotland. You could feel quite tropical, this, I think, on a really sunny summer's day. Yeah. Yes, this is very nice, very pleasant indeed.
Stretching for miles along this section of coastline, the white sands of Lus Kentire provide a truly beautiful and unique seascape. Coupled with stunning views of the Isle of Tarensay, made famous by the television series Castaway and the dramatic backdrop of the Harris Mountains across the Sound, it's easy to see why this beach was ranked alongside those in Florida and South Africa. An average sea temperature of 7 degrees Celsius, however, does serve as an effective reminder of its location, something which also means it is much more peaceful than its warmer counterparts. However, Luskentyr accounts for only a small part of a truly remarkable landscape that helps make Harris such a unique and unspoiled island. We regrettably do have to leave Harris though, and the ferry takes us to the next stop on our journey, the small island of Bernere. Lying between Harris and North Uist, the island of Bernere is very accessible, linked to Leverburgh by ferry since 1990, and to North Uist by causeway since 1999. The island is home to a rich mix of wildlife, and you don't have to go very far to find it.
We're currently at the seal viewing area. Just behind me, you can see some seals basking on the rocks.
In addition to the tourism which such natural wonders bring, the other main industries on the island are fishing, crofting, and since the provision of broadband in 2006, media and IT services. This facility has meant there is less need to leave the island for work, something which we've also seen across many other Hebridean isles, as communities are left with little option but to adjust their ways of life to survive. As we continue our journey south to North Uist, we travel over the Bernere Causeway, a 900 metre stretch of road built to link both islands, and which replaced the passenger ferry between them in 1999. Covering an area of 117 square miles, North Uist is the smaller of the two Uists, and is largely flat, characterised by its so-called drowned landscape of peat bogs and lochans. The largest settlement on the island is Loch Maddy, an historic fishing port, and now the administrative centre of the island. From here, it is possible to explore several trails around the area.
So, as part of the Uist sculpture trail, about 20 minutes into the walk, you come across this stone building. It's called the Hut of Shadow, and it's a camera obscura. Mirrors project the surrounding landscape outside onto this white stone surface. And if we turn our camera light off, we should be able to see the image.
Although perhaps not the most effective way of showing what's on the outside, it nevertheless is an interesting concept. North Uist has a rich and at times turbulent settlement history, and features of these periods are evident across the island, not least to the southwest of Loch Maddy.
Well, we haven't come all the way up this wet and windy hillside to see what appears to be a pile of rubble. It is, in fact, Barpa langaes, a Neolithic chambered cairn, and the best preserved of its type in the Hebrides. It's an impressive structure. At 78 feet in diameter and 18 feet tall, it really does stand out in the landscape. Behind me is the entrance to the cairn, where there are thought to be at least three burial chambers. Sadly, due to a rock collapse, the inside of the cairn is now deemed too unsafe to enter.
Standing prominent on the hill and overlooking Loch Barpa below, it has been suggested that the cairn is the tumulus of an eminent warrior or a Neolithic tribe who lived nearby. To this day, the site still intrigues archaeologists and visitors alike, and serves as a reminder of the complex settlement history of these isles. But for us, it's time to leave and travel on to South Uist, the next stop in our journey, and which takes us over a series of causeways and the neighbouring isle of Benbecula. The route between the islands of the Outer Hebrides is today far easier than it was before 1960, when this, the North Ford Causeway, the longest causeway in the Western Isles, was opened. It took a team of 90 workers 3 years to complete the 5-mile road link between North Uist and Benbecula, using 350,000 tons of rock. Up until this point, islanders had relied on boats or local guides leading them on foot across the ford, a crossing flanked by dangerous quicksand and only passable at low tide. The guides would often have to find new routes amid the continually shifting sandbanks. Such was the enormity of the task that one local remarked he had been to Japan on national service before he had visited neighbouring Benbecula. However, this project was part of a much larger vision, which since 1975 has been further driven by the newly formed Western Isles Council. The problem was that over the past 150 years, many of the outlying islands had lost their populations due to isolation, some now completely deserted. In order to ensure the survival of the remaining Outer Hebrides community, economic development is seen as vital, and key to this are solid inter-island transport links. The result is a remarkable multi-agency investment of over £30 million in the last decade, resulting in a network of new and re-engineered roads, bridges, causeways, and ferry terminals and routes, stretching north to south along this so-called spinal route. The causeways are feats of engineering in themselves, with construction of the most recent link, the Eriskay Causeway, ending in 2001. Linking Eriskay with South Uist, the project was the largest civil engineering project underway in the United Kingdom at the time, opening up Eriskay to the rest of the Western Isles. These projects have meant that it is now far easier to travel from Lewis in the north through to Vattisay in the south, not only ending the isolation of these isles and creating larger markets for local products, leading to local economic growth, but also providing easier access to vital services for locals, resulting in a much improved quality of life for these communities. From Benbecula, South Uist is then reached by the South Ford Causeway, built in 1982 to replace the then deteriorating original bridge crossing. An island famous for its rolling macaire, it is also 100% community owned, and like all communities in the Hebrides, it is unique. Standing prominent on Rouval Hill is a figure which symbolises the fight to keep it that way. This impressive statue is Our Lady of the Isles.
It's over 10 metres high and weighs 40 tonnes. It was commissioned shortly after the Ministry of Defence proposed a missile testing site nearby. The residents of the island were concerned that the site would damage or destroy the local way of life here on the island, and therefore commissioned this statue, which represents everything that the island and its way of life stands for.
The statue was built with two intentions. The first was to show the devotion the islanders had to the Virgin Mary. The second, and perhaps more revealing, was to serve as a permanent reminder to non-locals that they were entering a different world to where they had come from. The statue's construction was supported by people from all faiths, contributing to the cost and to the labour required to build the foundations and approach road. Looking out from Rouval Hill, it's easy to understand why the islanders wanted to protect their community and way of life. A major milestone towards this was achieved in 2006, when a community company purchased the land from a sporting syndicate for £4.5 million, a purchase which was, at the time, Scotland's largest ever community buyout. As a result, the islanders are now responsible for their own future, enabling them to not only preserve the magical nature of the island, but also to develop new ways of economic and cultural development. One of the key areas requiring preservation is the macaque.
We're on the largest macaque in Scotland. It runs 20 miles either side of me. Now, a macaque is a coastal grassy plain, very fertile soils. It was once a beach, but has been left elevated from the current beach due to a drop in sea level. The fertility of the ground here is largely due to the fact that seashells make up the majority of it, up to 90% sometimes. This fertility gives rise to a diverse ecosystem, with wildflowers flourishing and a diverse bird population as well. Humans have also cultivated the land to grow crops. However, this can bring its own issues.
70% of all macaque is found in the Western Isles, and it has been worked by man through low-intensity crofting for generations, becoming an intrinsic part of the way of life here. In turn, this supports both the community and wildlife, creating a unique habitat. However, partly as a result of reduced incentives for farmers to continue such environmental management schemes, there have been changes in the way the macaque is cultivated, including earlier crop harvesting and intensification of grass silage production. As a result, the condition of the macaque, as well as the plant and animal species it supports, are now under threat.
A few miles further down the west coast of the island, you can still find the vast grassy plains of the macaque. And standing here, you really do get a sense of just how big it is.
Such is the importance of this landscape that the RSPB, Scottish Natural Heritage and Western Isles Council, supported by the EU, have set up the Macaque Life Project through raising awareness of crofting and farming communities to this plight and implementing and demonstrating sustainable management methods. It is hoped that the project will help to find new methods of harmonising conservation and agriculture on this precious landscape. But, as in many cases of this kind, only time will tell if it can be successful. A short drive south, crossing over the causeway, we reach Eriskay, bringing us ever closer to our final destination.
Well, we've arrived at the Eriskay ferry terminal and are about to board a ferry which will take us to the island of Barra.
Aside from the ferry terminal, Eriskay is also known for being the location where Bonnie Prince Charlie landed to start the Jacobite Rebellion in 1745. It is also where a cargo ship named the SS Politician ran aground, with a cargo of 240,000 bottles of whiskey, originally destined for America, scattered along the shore. The islanders made sure not to let it go to waste. The incident was later made famous in a book entitled Whiskey Galore, and subsequently a film of the same name. The short crossing takes us to the final destination on our trip, and an island famed for offering sandy beaches, hills, macaque and moorland, all within one small area of land. Once the stronghold of the mighty Clan MacNeil in the 11th century, with the only significant surviving medieval fortification, Kishmuir Castle, the centre of power, the Isle of Barra was gifted by its modern-day owner to the community in 2003.
And so, it's time to bring our journey, what a journey it has been, across the Hebrides to a close. But what better a place to end than the island of Barra? Barra has been described as being like the Hebrides in miniature. It has everything that the Hebrides has to offer. Dramatic and rugged landscapes, beautiful coastlines and beaches, a rich history and heritage, tradition, culture, and of course, a friendly and welcoming population. As well as these similarities, the Hebridean islands are different. They all have their own unique characteristic. They all have their own feel, their own identity. And this makes the Hebrides a truly fascinating, memorable, and special place.